great to see so many folks out on Monday morning, day after Super Bowl. We all survived. Not many smiles out there. One smile could have been worse. Could not have gotten there, but welcome everyone. I'm Senator Michael Rogers from Westport. I am the co-chair of the Senate Committee on Strengthening Massachusetts Local Retail. And before you, members of the task force appointed by the Senate President, and it's our charge to review and report on efforts to strengthen our local retail sector here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And it's important for us to do that, in order to do that, that we listen to those in the retail sector of the economy. We have had hearings at the State House. We have had hearings down in Cape Cod. We are today in Western Mass. We also are going to get to the North Shore and Merrimack Valley because local retail is really global. And what affects retail in Boston is certainly different than what affects retail down the Cape or out in Western Mass, or certainly up in the Merrimack Valley where they border New Hampshire. So what I'd like to do is, do we have the portable microphone? Kelly, can you bring that up here? Because I'd like to have the members of the task force introduce themselves. We apologize. We generally have name tags, so you all know who we are. A little mixed up this morning, we don't have them, but if we could have everyone please introduce themselves, who they are, and what their affiliation is.
Thank you. I'm Peter Cavanaugh. I'm a small business owner from the South Coast in Northampton, Massachusetts.
Good morning. My name is John Hirsch. I'm president of the Retailers Association of Massachusetts.
Good morning. My name is John Kingle. I'm the director of marketing at Landry & Acari Rugs & Carpeting. We're headquartered out of Salem, Mass.
Good morning. I'm Judy Herrell. I own Herrell's Ice Cream in Northampton. Thank you all for coming.
I'm Vinny DiPosito. I'm the state senator for the Plymouth and Barnstable District, where the bridges are, and then over to Cape Cod. And I'll be coaching, just in case you don't know. But I'm also the co-chair of the Regional Task Force Committee.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Don Humason. I'm from Westfield, senator for the 2nd Camden, New Hampshire District. I just want to say a couple of quick thank yous to my fellow task force member from Western Massachusetts, Judy Herrell. Yeah, we're trying to put this thing together. I'd like to thank the folks here at Union Station for this great space. I'd like to thank my fellow colleagues on the task force for coming all the way out to Western Massachusetts to hear us, because I think that we have a lot to say to the issue in regards to retail and the effects of what the Commonwealth does, legislatively, regulatory, is that the word? How was that? It was late night last night. But I especially want to thank all of you for being here, so thank you.
Executive Director of the Massachusetts State Council of the Service Employees International Union, SEIU, and representing over 100,000 service workers in the state of Massachusetts. Also, Board of Boston, who grew up here in the Northampton area.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Jim Carabolo. I'm the Political Director for the United Food and Commercial Workers Union, Local 1445, USCIU, United Food and Commercial Workers. We represent almost 40,000 retail grocery store workers in the state of Massachusetts.
Good morning, I'm Barry Rotman from Rotman's. I've been headed to the east in Worcester. We retail furniture, carpeting, and bedding, flooring. I'm glad to be here.
My name is Christopher Carlosi. I'm the state director of the National Federation of Independent Business, NFIB. Thank you for coming out.
Thank you all. So if please feel free, we really like these hearings to be more of a conversation and a dialogue. When we get to that hot portion of the agenda, please raise your hand. We'll bring a microphone over to you. You can ask us any questions, submit any comments, just tell us what's on your mind. And we heard from Senator Humason, host here, co-host here, a Our other host is Judy Herrell, member of the task force. And Judy, would you like to say welcome?
Hi folks, I'm sorry. It's okay. As everybody knows, information is power, and I think that for all of our sakes in the retail end of businesses, there's a lot of challenges, and in order to be competitive in the marketplace in Massachusetts, we need to understand clearly what those challenges are, and they're able to make good legislation for everybody to be able to work and thrive in the state. I thank you all for coming and for sharing all of the information that you have about the challenges that you see. Thank you.
We're also joined this morning by Mayor David Nockowitz and Mr. Mayor. Would you like to say a few words?
Very few.
I think Kelly's going to bring the microphone out.
Politician, I want to say a few words.
I just want to welcome and thank the task force for having this hearing today, and obviously thank Judy Herrell, owner of the best ice cream on the planet. And also thank Senator Humason as well, the other Western Mass representative. If you spend any time in Northampton, you'll understand that small local retail is one of the key components of our economy. It's what has differentiated Northampton from so many other downtowns across the state and across the country, because we still have locally owned stores, bookstores, ice cream shops, coffee shops, etc. I think it's really what, it's the key to the strength of our economy, so I appreciate the work you're doing going around the state and hearing from local retailers about what we need to do to maintain those kinds of businesses in Northampton and across the state. So thank you and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And we have a few other folks that would like to give us a welcome and an overview of key issues from our chamber, Chambers of Commerce. First, from the Greater Holyoke Chamber of Commerce, we have Kathleen Annis.
Anyways, I want to welcome you here this morning. Thank you for being here in Western Massachusetts and listening to the concerns that we have out here in Western Mass. I happen to be the Chamber President. I'm proud to be the Chamber President in Holyoke. We also have a foundation that runs an entrepreneurship program that was funded by the Boston Federal Reserve Working Cities Challenge Grants. My background also, though, I was the Economic Development Director for the City of Holyoke, and I worked as the Mayor's Chief of Staff. So I worked for the city for 12 years, and then before that, I was a teacher. And I just, I don't know, anyways, I took a whole different shift. But the point is, I had a lot of experience in looking at how to draw business to our communities as an economic development professional. I also meet with the Western Mass Economic Development Council, which is all of the Western Mass economic development folks meet on a monthly basis to look at how we can bring business and grow businesses in all of the communities in Western Massachusetts. And former Senator Knappick, I sat on a committee with him, and said it better than anyone, we have five gateway cities out in Western Massachusetts. Those five, there's no other area in Massachusetts that have five gateway cities that are all close to each other like they are in Western Massachusetts. And along with gateway cities, you know what happens. It's aging infrastructure, there's usually poverty, there's challenges with getting people back to work. There's many challenges though that we find with buildings, and renovating space and the cost of renovating space. And so we talk about this at the Western Mass EDC group on how do we get more shovel-ready properties for retail and small businesses to come, because we grew in the last 3 years. I've started over 30 businesses and we've helped 11 businesses refine through the Spark program, which is our entrepreneurship program, and that's all the stuff I got in my bag for you. It's the stats on how we've been able to grow business, but we're looking at growing low-income, primarily Latino-owned businesses. And so I'm really firsthand understanding the struggles that our businesses are facing in the community. You know, as a chamber president, we're helping businesses that are currently up and running, and you're helping them to market themselves, to network with each other so that they're successful, and you help to create a good business climate as a chamber president or head of a chamber. But with the entrepreneurship program, I'm finding that access to capital becomes very challenging. You know, it's easy to charge on your credit card up to $5,000 or something like that. It's, you know, the $5,000 to $30,000 access to capital that becomes really difficult. And so we're helping people to get to that point, and we've been able to find through some state grants, which have been very helpful, some funding through the Urban Agenda grants and some other things, but it has to go to a nonprofit, which is my Chamber Foundation hat that I wear. And with those fundings, we're able to give small businesses those startup funds and the $5,000, the $10,000. So we've given, there's a couple of our Spark graduates in the room sitting right behind me, they've got my back. And they can tell you themselves later maybe the challenges that they face as small businesses. So I just want to point out a couple of other things. Space costs are extremely difficult. And again, I was the economic development director in Holyoke, and so that was my job, is let's try and find more space for people to move into. And we have older buildings that have property owners that, if you drive downtown Holyoke, probably all of the storefronts are full. But when you look above, it's all vacant. If the majority of those properties are vacant. Why? Because the cost to renovate the upstairs and get elevators and things like that are very difficult. And I know, I think it was in Greenfield, did some creative stuff where they got some state funding. Again, it's all, you know, helping with state funding or federal funding, but they got some funding to put a common elevator that helped a couple of buildings to make them handicap accessible. So it's things like that. Permitting, any additional permitting that is put on a small business, especially a startup, and the statistics show that the first 5 years are the most crucial. And we're working through our own challenges in our own community with permitting, but I know back a couple of, one governor ago, I know Secretary Bielecki had gone through permitting to look at what hindered business startup. And what was the regulations within state government that was hindering startup of businesses and expansion of businesses? And so I urge you to look at what is really challenging businesses that you could do away with, that's redundant, and things like that. And I'm challenging our own community to do those same things. The other thing, and then I'll be quiet and pass the mic over to my camarade over here. Is this okay?
This is helpful.
Okay. Wages, well, I think while the entrepreneur or the small business wants to support minimum wage increases, it makes it very challenging at the same time when there's trying to start and hire their first employee or their second employee. And so I think that becomes challenging. The other thing that I don't know the answer to this, but I think it's something that to think about, is we do a lot of marketing on the state level of buying, you know, within our own communities or by local. We had a startup who made socks. It's Lenny, the name of his business is Upscale Socks. And he was trying to find someone, his idea was to make socks. And he used one of the other entrepreneurs to create the designs on his socks. So they were using each other's businesses to help each other, which is wonderful to see. And he could not find anywhere in Massachusetts to manufacture his socks. China made it really easy for him to go there. And while I don't support that, or he doesn't either, it was really easy for him. Whether it was the marketing, the cost, I don't know, but we have to make it easier for startups to find what they need right here in Massachusetts. And really encouraging each other to use each other as local businesses. I think that's it. I know I'll think of things later, but I think everyone else panelists here will have some great insight for you as well. Really, thank you for being here. And I'm around. I do have some packets. I didn't know how many people would be here. I think I have 10, and I've written on one of them. And I'll pass those out for some statistics on our entrepreneurship program and things like that. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen. Are we here for Susan?
Sure. I am going to stand up, primarily because there are so many people from Northampton that are my close colleagues, and I hope we'll be hearing from all of you about your experiences doing the extraordinary work that you do here in Northampton. I'd like to point out Amy Kangley, who is the director of Northampton Downtown, Downtown Northampton Association, which was recently formed as part of the chamber to do exactly what you're hoping to do, which is find ways to strengthen the local retail sector and the environment downtown. I think my opening, the most important thing that I can open with is to say that this area, Northampton and beyond, has an extraordinary local independent economy. It's a priceless local independent economy, and it's unusual to have a strong local independent economy in Western Massachusetts. Someone mentioned deteriorating downtown, so the mayor might have mentioned that. We're not in that situation. We're in a more fortunate position. I hope that you're going to hear from our local independent businesses about the cost of doing business. I'm sure that's been a theme that has run through a lot of the testimony you've gotten. The difficulty of expanding markets, finding new markets when the online competition is pulling business away from your business, where are those new sales and revenues going to come from? The unfair competitive advantages of online retailers, I'm sure that's been a theme also across the state. What I'd like to kind of set the stage with is just to help all of us understand the impact of a successful retail sector on so many other parts of our community and sectors of our economy. For example, if you go up and down, I'll use Northampton as an example because it's the one I'm most familiar with, but if you're up and down the streets, Main Street in Northampton, and you go into some of the beautiful shops and you eat in the restaurants, what you're really seeing is a marketplace for the crafts, for fine arts, and other products that are created in our area and sold on Main Street in Northampton. So the significance of that is that without that local independent business who's buying those locally produced products, whether it's art or crafts or jewelry, without their market to have on Main Street, then they wouldn't be able to exist if they exist. So that connection to creative sector, the same connection can be talked about in terms of the ag sector, the restaurants here. I'll use Northampton as an example, but pretty much every restaurant in downtown Northampton, you look at the bottom of the menu and it tells you exactly where the eggs came from and where the bread came from and where the spinach came from and what have you. And the special menus for every day has, you know, extraordinary amount of local food that's been produced. And then Northampton and the restaurants and many others beyond Northampton are the marketplace for those local farms. So the overall point is the interdependence of our local independent retail economy with our local independent other economic sectors. I've mentioned the arts and food. The most important thing that our local independent economy does for us is it creates the character of our community. We're all very familiar, right? We've seen destinations, whether for visitors or we've been to them ourselves, of places that have been overtaken by large corporate chains, and they certainly have a place in an economy. We're fortunate in that we have enough of a critical mass of locally owned independent businesses that they determine the character of our community. And that's ultimately, in some ways, their biggest value to us, because they are representing the values of our community by taking the risk of being a small business owner and investing in not only their own success or their employees' success, but also the success of so many businesses that are connected to theirs. So I'd like to just make a few recommendations if I could. Starting with a recommendation that when the legislature takes on individual policies, and you're probably going to hear about minimum wage and other cost of doing business policies and legislation, a recommendation that when that is done and when you're setting a priority or you're making social change through the legislation, let's say, that you're considering, that definitely resonates with the values of people in this area, people in Western Massachusetts, and business owners in Western Massachusetts. But what seems to be missing or has been missing is an approach to considering legislation that is balanced with legislation that might offset the impact that so that the impacts are balanced, so that we're not sacrificing one aspect of our economy for a important priority on or policy on income inequality, for example. So that may not have been very well said, but I think you understand what I'm talking about, is that it's important to look holistically, which I think is part of what you're here for, to look at things holistically. I would also like the legislature to consider supporting the tourism district legislation that's under consideration this year. And the value of that to local communities is it gives local communities the option to raise additional funds for marketing those local communities. If this is possible under the state legislature, to introduce legislation to institute sales tax for online retailers, I think that would probably be universally recommended. To continued investment of the hotel tax for destination marketing, as I said, visitors that come to this area have replaced some of the sales that have gone online, for example. So the visitors are becoming a more and more important part of our economy, and obviously that creates a lot of state tax revenues as well. The last recommendation would be for the legislature to be proactive. This is more specific than the others, but proactive in providing resources to mitigate the potential unknown at this point impacts from the MGM casino development. To continue to invest, as the Mass Gaming Commission has invested in Northampton, in ongoing grants. I know the legislation includes a lot of monitoring of what's happening, but to really pay attention to the impact that a destination like that could have on the very fragile economies that we're going to be talking about today, and businesses, I should say. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Suzanne, and once again to Kathleen. I want to take this opportunity to introduce a member of the task force, a colleague of mine, Senator Julian Sia, who gets the award for traveling the furthest today. From his home in Truro at Cape Cod, and he was our host a couple of weeks ago down at Cape at the last retail task force hearing. So, welcome, Senator.
Thank you.
Okay, now it's your turn. Please, don't be shy. Raise your hand. And stand, Dave, okay, Kelly, and Kelly will bring the microphone. You don't have to, you just stand up and stand right there. And welcome anything and everything you have to say.
Hi, so first, thanks for coming. My name is Dave Rodner. I own Dave Soda in Penn City. I have seven stores in Western Mass. I have 160 employees. I have 35, this is my 42nd year of being in business, and this is the most challenging year that we have faced. And a lot of the challenges are from legislation that have been passed that are really unfriendly to small businesses, especially brick and mortar retailers. I'm going to start with something that hits me every day, which is the sales tax from e-commerce sites. I compete with Petco, PetSmart, Pets Plus Plus, now Pet Value, all these brick and mortar stores which I can very easily compete with. I cannot compete with Chewy.com, which does not have to charge sales tax. Four or five times a day, someone's in my store with their phone has the product that they're going to buy at the price, and I'm immediately at a 6.25, whatever it is, percent disadvantage. With margins that are, everybody here is feeling, that are getting cramped, you can't survive doing this. And as everybody knows, e-commerce ain't going away. So I don't understand why the state is not collecting sales tax. It's a killer for retailers, for good morning. Second thing, which is I find very interesting, is that we are, I don't know if everybody knows this, one of two states in the country that has to pay time and a half on Sundays. So while we have to pay time and a half on Sundays at my place and at your place, and let's say I have folks in my warehouse part of my store fulfilling orders. Amazon opens up a warehouse in Massachusetts, has workers fulfilling orders on Sunday. They do not have to pay overtime. How is that fair by any stretch of imagination? Right? It doesn't make sense. Health insurance. So I have 160 employees. We have 35 people on our health insurance plan. Our average, our monthly bill to Cigna is about $24,000 a month, which our company share is $17,000 a month. So we have a great health insurance plan. We had a 40% increase on our last renewal. 40%. I cannot ask my guys, my folks, to come up with the extra 40%. So we ate it. I guarantee you that everybody in this room who owns a business is paying 30% or more for their insurance than any municipality, anybody who belongs to a union, anybody who belongs to a big business. So to make matters worse, and this to me is the ultimate slap in the face, I read that even though I'm offering health insurance to all my employees and a great plan, if my employees decide not to take my plan, I'm getting whacked another $750 per employee. Who thinks up this stuff? It is absolutely unfair. Period. End of story. We can compete with other bricks and mortars. We cannot compete when everything is just stacked against us. It's just not fair. So those are just a few of my, it's not even pet peeves, it's just why it's so hard to do business. And you know, and I get calls from real estate agents, do you want to open up new stores? Why? Why would I want to? How is it possible that the minimum wage can go up and we don't have a starting wage for young people who need the jobs more than anybody. So all of us are gonna pay $22.50 an hour for a kid to work on Sundays? You can't stay in business. Doesn't it make sense to have a starting wage for young people to get into the workforce? It's a win-win for everyone. So that's my I'll go away now. Thanks.
Thank you, Dave. Yes, Kelly, behind you, gentleman in the back. Good morning.
I might as well piggyback with David. Somehow or another, I think we went to the same school. I know I look a lot younger than him, but we're the same age. I'm Ted from Teddy Gear Pools and Spas. I did slutter all the way through high school, so come on out of my shell. I have a business. I've been in the industry for 52 years, 42 of my own, like David. I have over 100 employees seasonally. I only have about 50 right now. And it's a challenge. Everything David and I already talked, or he talked about, I feel the same way. Why not, when I was a kid, we had a minimum wage for kids under 16. 14 to 16, the restaurant business, retail business, start off at $8.50 an hour. I got kids, I just want to have carriages out. I can't afford to do that anymore. Time and a half on Sundays. It's unbelievable. I can't afford it. The margins are shrinking. Workman's comp, health insurance. I try to be generous, 80% on single, 50% on family. I can't take it away from them because they think I'm the crook. My insurance is probably not as bad as yours, David. Mine's only gone about 28% last year. Such a deal. But the bottom line is, it would be great if we could work together as human beings. This corporate bid theater is not going to go away. The internet's not going to go away. But we can work together as citizens of this state. And I mean not just the politicians, not just the business people, but also the employees, to work together as a team. To turn this thing around to be successful, really successful for everyone. And everything David brought up, I feel exactly the same way about it. A minimum wage for different people in retail business. Time and a half, really got to think about that twice. Hard to take things away from people. And you know that, and I know that. But we're required to offer insurance, pay insurance. And I got to move for you. This is stacked. Last 3 years. People come in for a job. You ready for this? We have the stats. 37% of them do not have a valid driver's license. They'll show me a valid driver's license and we can check it out. 37% is not valid. 68% of people apply for a job. Can you pass a drug test? Oh yeah, I do drugs. I'm being funny. 68% can't pass a drug test. This is what we're dealing with. And with my type of business, and I'm sending someone to your house, driving my trucks, I have to quit. If I don't, my insurance rates go sky high. So I appreciate that the politicians are out there going to politics and be abused. I wouldn't want to be in politics. But we need to work together as a team, as citizens of this state, this country, to turn things around. Otherwise, we're not going to be in business. Thank you.
Right up front again? Yes.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Kate Field. I'm the Executive Director of the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce, and I want to keep the conversation going, even though it may sound like a broken record. But we're talking about high energy costs, high wages, if we get to a $15 minimum wage, paid family leave back of 26 weeks will definitely be a detriment to some of our businesses in the worst way possible. And then, of course, as already has been said, the businesses are being penalized for underwriting mass health, the gap in mass health, the shortfall. But I want to tell a couple of stories for my chamber members. One of them is a small retail grooming business. She's been in business for over 12 years. She's worked very hard to promote her business. She does dog grooming and she sells product. We all know about the online sales issue, but I think we need to keep talking about this. She was selling increasing until 3 years ago. The combination of a large pet retailer came into town. We had PetSmart come into Westfield. And then the influx of the online promotion through pet retailers as Chewy.com and PetFlow.com, as David mentioned, from David's pet store. So it's impossible for them to compete with these online retail stores, retail sales. It's just, it really hurts them when they don't have to pay the sales tax. And another woman I spoke to, her business, even though it's not Westfield, she actually has to be she's my son's mother-in-law. But she has a business in Agawam. And she was telling me over the weekend that she sells a bird cage. I'm going to read this really slowly because she sells her wholesale cost of a bird cage is $1 more than what Amazon sells at retail. Think about that. Her wholesale cost is $1 more than what the average consumer can get it online. How long do you think she'll stay in business? So it's really a challenge. I also want to mention that I know some of the nonprofits, like the Boys and Girls Club and YMCAs, if it does go to $15 an hour minimum wage, I know they're talking about $500,000 that it's going to cost their budget. One of them is up to $1.5 million to their budget. And these are, you know, transitional employees, college kids that are having a summer job. So this is going to be a huge issue. And I like the way, and I might be not interpreting Suzanne's comments, but this is where the inequities, Western Mass versus Eastern Mass. You know, we can't, I don't think we can absorb that out here, maybe as much as Eastern Mass can. So maybe there can be, I'm not sure if that's legal, or maybe the legislature can do something about that. But that's something that needs to be looked at regionally. I also would like to bring up regional transit authorities, because when you talk about the brick and mortars in our downtowns and people getting a decent job or supporting the local businesses, there's just not enough bus routes out here. I know there's Uber and Lyft issues. I know those are options. But Westfield is a gateway city as well. We're one of those gateway cities. So when you're looking at socioeconomic structure, the fabric of our community, even that might not be an option. I'm assuming the PDTAs of the world are a little bit cheaper than your Ubers and Lyft. I've never used them. But it's definitely a concern at where we are. There's just not enough bus routes, and that's a huge concern. And that's those are all my stories for today. So thank you for your time, and thank you for coming here today. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning.
I don't know which way to face. They get the globe on the globe. My name's Chuck Kelly, and I'm here to represent my wife as a florist. And a lot of what Ted had to say and Dave had to say, she's in a very labor-intensive environment. So a third of her cost is labor. And in a retail sector in a higher volume, probably about 10-15% maybe, but it's a third of her cost. Valentine's Day is coming up, okay? We took minimum wage and grew it up 37% to $11 per hour. She's going to take on 15 temporary employees and she's going to make nothing, because it's all going right back up the door. And that's what's happening with the point. Going to 15, and we hear the headwinds, and we've heard from Senate leadership that if we don't do it through legislation, we'll do it in the ballot box. That was a few months ago. It's fine. We're preparing for that. In the end result of what happened with the $11 an hour is very simple. Payroll is the same. She got home last night just in time to turn on the Super Bowl, because that's what we do. We're in there 7 days a week. I don't draw a salary. I retired 5 years ago from a career to help her out. I don't draw a salary, so I was told that I'm not an employee, I'm a slave. That's my So it's a very true issue. She has hired one high school kid to do some e-commerce work for her since the minimum wage has gone to $11. She's hired them all the time. They come in the afternoon to clean up, they do some landscaping, and things like that for her. So if sole proprietorships are not very loud out here in the economy, you're getting hit hard. This $15 an hour looks great for Walmart, looks great for maybe Big Y, looks great for the people with hundreds and hundreds of employees. But for a sole proprietorship, they look at it and say, I just have to do more work. I need that eighth day. You know, so you really have to look at that. To the overtime piece that was brought up about Sundays, Christmas was on a Monday. My wife refused orders, she just couldn't do it. So what we did was, those folks that hired through Gatherers, 800 flowers, and you know, all those pro flowers and all that, just, even if they were profitable, I refused them, took care of our customers that called directly or ordered on our website. She reduced the size of the business and our people didn't get paid, because she just couldn't pay that overtime on Sunday, because Christmas was a Monday. When Valentine's Day is on a Monday or a Sunday, it's brutal, because there's nothing to be made. And that has to do with that overtime on Sunday. But now it has even more to do with what's, you know, with the winds we're facing coming at us with that minimum wage. So it really should be looked at. I'd like to take a second to talk about what Kathy talked about, infrastructure in downtowns, you know, up from Westfield. Westfield's a great little downtown with one retail establishment. Two is a bookstore now, amongst restaurants and ice cream stores and all that. Great stuff, I had a lot of fun, believe me. Steel rails, people just give them to me because they
in the list, but I like to drink, walk into the tavern or whatever. But, you know, the buildings are crumbling somewhat. And the Westfield one fell, and they finally took it down, and they have a lot, they can't find anybody to build on it. It's a beautiful plaza down 2 miles away on East Main Street. I know there's nothing we can do about ADA, but that's where the cost of really redoing these buildings comes into play. My wife owns a house that she sells out of that was grandfathered, built in 1856. There is absolutely no way she could make that building handicapped accessible. It would just put her right out of business. So we just trying to keep it up, you know. So there's a lot of things to do about infrastructure, and I know Holyoke and Westfield, you know, those downtowns really need that. And the point that was made about feeding off of other businesses in your neighborhood, you know, my wife buys all her stationery from a local printer, like him. And it is extremely expensive. Vista Print, you can just go right on there and take care of it. Now, I don't know what to do about all that, but we fight to buy locally as much as we can buy locally. I'm going to stop, but I think the biggest point that I wanted to make was about payroll costs, because she's in a very labor-intensive environment. And if we don't look at the mom-and-pop operations for what they have for labor and think that this minimum wage isn't going to make a difference, it will make a big difference to what happens in our downtown retail locations. Thank you.
Thanks, John.
Appreciate all the Senate
senators for coming out for this hearing. And I'm here today because my understanding is that restaurants haven't been well represented at these hearings. We are the other side of retail on the main streets of Massachusetts. And in fact, we have over 15,300 restaurants in Massachusetts. And I just want to spend a couple seconds here to talk about the recent past and how it's affected the restaurant industry. You know, the years 2008 to 2010 were clearly the most challenging years that any restaurant operator has ever seen. It was the most challenging years that a lot of different industries have ever seen. But it affected restaurants particularly hard because during those times when people were really reining in discretionary spending, there is no more discretionary spending than going out to lunch on a Tuesday afternoon or dinner on a Wednesday night. And so we were particularly hit hard during those times. So imagine being an operator during those days, if you would, and they actually recovered from that tumultuous time. So in the 7 years since we recovered from the Great Recession, small operators have had to adjust to the following items. Three wage increases totaling 37.5% of the starting wage for employees, resulting in the highest starting wage in the United States. With any increase, as we just heard, it's not just that starting wage, it's the compression. So jobs that 2 years ago were being paid $11 an hour are now at $13, $14, $15. Jobs that were at $15 an hour 2 years ago are now at $18 to $20 an hour. If you're a full-service restaurant, you also have a 42.5% increase to tipped employees. Tipped employees are the highest paid employees in any full-service restaurant. A lot of times averaging $18, $20, $25, $30 an hour. Paying money to those folks who are already the highest paid wage earners in the restaurant takes away the amount of money that an owner can spend on his or her true hourly employees that are looking for those wages. We've also had to deal with mandatory paid sick days for everybody, but especially for those 16, 17, and 18-year-old employees. That's particularly hard to hit because we're teaching life skills to these employees as they enter the workforce, some of whom will stay in our industry for many years, some of whom learn the skills that they need to move into other fields and become sometimes senators or, you know, working in insurances or banks. That's what restaurants do. We teach them the responsibilities of becoming an adult. For those operators that can afford health insurance, we've seen double-digit increases, 40% in some cases, obviously, but double-digit increases every year since 2008. We've seen an assessment now for employees that receive assistance from MassHealth. The particularly difficult problem here is that we have operators that are doing their best to offer insurance to their employees, but because the state can offer a better plan at less money and has marketed it, we're now being held responsible for the buying decision of an employee who makes a good buying decision. They're buying a better plan at a less price, but the employer now has to pay for that responsibility. The labor force, and again, this is part of the reason that I think you don't see a lot of restaurateurs here. There is no restaurant in Massachusetts currently that's staffed, zero. I've been in this business 38 years, it has never been worse. And that's partially due to the demographics and the changing ages of people and how many are in the stratosphere, but it's a real event. The increased competition in the changing marketplace. Large-scale grocery stores have tremendous grab-and-go sections now. Wegmans, in their newest restaurant, is going to have two full-service restaurants within their building. And the most scary thing I've ever seen, you can actually buy sushi at Walgreens. I don't know who would do that. It terrifies me to think. But it's supplied there, so somebody's buying it. Landlords are raising rents to record highs. We have increased food costs, obviously. We have boutique law firms that are making a living out of every single small mistake that a small operator makes and making them pay a high price for it. We have communities that are asking for more and more liquor licenses, yet there's no increase in the population to go along with it. So what we're doing is we're spreading customers around existing restaurants, putting pressure on restaurants that are already there. And yet restaurants serve a customer base that will go out and say, geez, that place got a little pricey, because they're very price sensitive, I guess. The restaurant industry is extremely labor intensive. You have two line items in a restaurant that account for over 70% of every dollar that walks through the door. If a restaurant's doing a really good job, labor and food costs, if they're doing a good job, equal at least 70% of every dollar that walks through the door. The average profit in a restaurant is 5 cents on the dollar when the other costs are taken into account. That means if you sell a hamburger and fries for $7, you subtract the cost of sourcing, buying, preparing, garnishing, and serving that burger with a bun, lettuce, tomato, onions, french fries, on a plate that the owner bought, on the table that she owns, with the napkin, silverware that he or she buys, you don't make $7, you make 35 cents. Now imagine if the server breaks a glass that costs a dollar. Imagine if a couple of the employees snap on the french fries that cost a dollar. Imagine if customers take too many napkins. All that cost is borne by the owner. So now he or she doesn't just have to worry about how many, one burger. They have to sell about 3 or 4 burgers to replace those costs. And we do that all in 14 meal periods that average about 2 to 2.5 hours a period. We need your help. Our industry is facing death by 1,000 cuts. These are really the true impacts of what's happening to restaurants on the main streets of Massachusetts. And we really appreciate you listening, and we really need your help. Thank you.
Well, the mic is always being transferred, and I just announced that we do have some legislative staff here from Senator Barrett's office, from Representative Baker's office, and from Representative Goldstein's Rose office. So thank you very much for being here, ma'am.
Employee, so when I come home from my day job, I'm
cleaning floors, you name it, I'm doing it. But that's really not, I don't want to echo what a lot of people have said today. The gentleman who spoke from the Restaurant Association, I will have to say that I agree with everything he said with the fact that rents are going up. I will tell you from our perspective, I would love to be in a property that rents are going up. One of the clearest thing I heard today is we're not all Boston. We're not all Copley, we're not all Prue, we're not South Shore, North Shore, Burlington. We're the Eastfield Malls of the world. We are the Berkshire Malls of the world. These are virtually dead properties. But I deal with tenants every day. I deal with local, national, and regional tenants every day. I have one tenant who runs a snack food business who's been there for 20 years. He was up for renegotiation for his two stores for lease this year. He would not do more than 3 years on his lease for fear of a $15 minimum wage. And Lynn Graves here from the Hampshire Mall as well. I can't tell you how many tenants we renew for 1 year, 2 year, 3 years that are scared to death to do a long-term lease. And that's even with market consolidation. We might be the only game in town, but they're still not willing to make that commitment. Our company operates centers in New York State. I can tell you right now, we cannot make a restaurant deal in New York State with a national restaurant tenant because they're already staring down the barrel of a $15 minimum wage. And there's a lot of other places they can go do business in New York State. It's just not happening. So, again, there's a lot of external pressures for all these businesses. For us in Holyoke, where we deal with one of the highest commercial tax rates in the state, we struggle to keep it under $40 a thousand, which is insane. We just passed the Community Preservation Act, and again, we all want to do that. Those are the things we want to do, but it's a veiled tax. It's something that hits business. Understand that these things that you're asking these businesses to do hit businesses directly. There's nobody else sharing these expenses. It's hitting businesses directly. It's a single payer system. We've got challenges. These guys can pay. My tenants can pay. Us as a landlord, we can pay. Well, at some point we can't pay. It's just the numbers don't work. I think the biggest thing, and I may go to Harold's once or twice, maybe three, four times a week, but that's my own personal problem. So, Judy and I see each other a lot. But in a business like that and all these other businesses, you cannot afford to incentivize an employee anymore. When you have to pay a starting employee $15 an hour, like they said here, how can you pay somebody who has experience? And you're going to create a workforce of people with no loyalty, where anywhere they can go, they can make a $15 minimum wage. So if they have a bad day at Harold's, or if they have a bad day at the florist, I'm just going to pick up and move. So any money that you've spent to train an employee, whatever investment you've made in this employee, it's gone. It has just walked out the door. I saw something, and I'll give up the mic because I'm a bit long-winded, and that's Kathy Anderson's fault. But again, I was in Harold's a couple times this week. Again, my personal problem. But there was earlier in the week, Allison was training a new manager. This gentleman was tickled pink. He was as happy as a clam. We went back this weekend, we talked to him about it. Yeah, he didn't think, oh yeah, it's great, it's good. That goes away. That kid, anybody can be that kid. He's happy, he's moved up the ranks, he's done his job, he's done it well. They recognize that at Harold's, and he's getting paid the dividends of his hard work. So again, I hate to be on the soapbox here, and again, I'm a little bit, of a different perspective because I'm from the mall, but it's not a different perspective. We're all in this together. So thank you for coming out, thank you for listening. I really appreciate it.
Loves the sales tax holiday. However, he has
has to order his inventory like in February or March, and then you cancel the sales tax holiday. So that would leave him with thousands and thousands of dollars of inventory that he could not sell. So I just want to put a, make a comment to you that if you're going to consider the sales tax holiday, you know the implications for the state, but let's either make it permanent or come up with better planning for the small retailer that has to have inventory well in advance. And one last comment about the $50 minimum wage. Maybe there's a way to have more state revenue to train our workforce to get better skilled, better jobs that, that pay more than $15 an hour into training dollars. And let's keep the minimum wage where it is, but invest more money into training so that the folks can get a better job than $15 an hour, just as far.
My apologies. Just one more thing. You know, I had some notes, but of course I'm not smart enough to use them. But you know, I think the other thing that we're not looking at here is I think the people that this is all intending, we all have good intentions. The people that we're trying to help will ultimately be the people that we will hurt the most. If you look at, you know, a company like Red Robin, they have eliminated busboy positions. $8 million to the bottom line. They have eliminated food expediters. $10 million to the bottom line. I think these are the people that we're trying to get into the workforce. And these are people that are being ushered out of the workforce. Somebody's already talked about automation. McDonald's announced this week that they're gonna open new stores, but what are they gonna have? They're gonna have self-service kiosks. Wendy's is doing the same thing. Panera's doing the same thing. So again, let's, you know, again, we all have good intentions. Let's focus on how do we make those good intentions work in the right way.
This is all great, by the way. Thank you all very much for participating. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Annabelle, and I have a shoe store in downtown Northampton. And every day, people come into my store, sometimes just to browse, sometimes to talk, hopefully to buy. And individually, these moments don't seem like anything of any consequence, but if I look at the end of a week or a month or a year, I realize this is the essence of what Northampton is. So I think it's important when you're making decisions to realize it can't be one size fit all. The stresses that my business are up against are different than a business of 20 employees, of 200, of 2,000. I think it's kind of ironic that I'm here to ask you to help protect my livelihood, of course, but also what I think makes Northampton really great. I think it's also important to note that obviously we're all getting squeezed. I do pay my employees $12.50, and I base that on the fact that that is what a living wage in Northampton is. The Fight for 15 is a lovely slogan. It's based out of Seattle and San Francisco. It doesn't cost $15 an hour to live in Northampton. I pay what's fair, and obviously it goes up to 15. It just means that I'll be working less and two part-time people won't have a job anymore. The other thing that's happening to me is obviously online retailers are cutting into my margins. To stay competitive, I try to stay within a percentage of two, but it's hard to police that. However, in France, they do stick to MSRPs and they're not having this sort of breakdown in retail that we are here. That on top of what Dave said, customers can get on their phone in my store and buy something at an immediate discount of 6.25%. They come into my shop, they use it as a showroom, and then they buy it from somebody else. They don't perceive this as stealing, but it certainly does feel that way. On top of that, I have to say the other thing that's very frustrating is that it's not necessarily higher wages or lower margins that are really going to hurt me, it's the lack of customers. More and more people are buying online, and that's maybe the change of the future, so it's my job to market my store to offer goods at a fair price and a good experience. But I do need help getting people to my shop. I think because we are in an area that's sort of on the edge of more rural areas, there's an opportunity there. People who don't have stores close by tend to go online. It's a benefit to them. But what I'd like to suggest is maybe the state coupling with regional and local chambers in order to really help us implement loyalty programs, getting people to understand that shopping local can help them. You do save a few pennies when you buy online, but obviously you're going to pay for it on the other end. Thank you.
That's out there in the economy.
maybe it's possible for the state government to capture some of this data from online sales and use it to be able to enforce the use tax. For example, every time, if I sell a guitar out of state, every time I fill out a shipping form, the name of the customer, the amount of that it's insured for, and where it's going. And there's data there. It doesn't cost very much, or it might not cost very much to try and capture that data and use that data to enforce the use tax. But on a $2,000 guitar, I have an automatic $125 disadvantage for against Amazon when I try and sell that. This is it's something that that you need to be talking about with your colleagues in other states. You need to be talking about it with our representatives in Washington to try and do something about it. When you raise the sales tax from 5 to 6.25%, that maybe it made up for that loss of revenue for a little while, but it's only for a little while. If you if you find the sales tax revenue declining, and you think, well, maybe if we raise it to 8%, we can get it back up there. You're compounding the situation and making it worse because you're making it even more difficult for people like me to sell these things and have those sales tax collected locally. So it has to be one of the most important issues facing state government, and it's really important for you guys to try and figure out a real solution to it, either capturing data and enforcing the use tax, or creating some kind of national value-added tax that will make sure that everybody pays to support the services that we need.
Thank you, guys. So I can just say, I know there's been a lot of discussion and questions about the sales tax. If we have time at the conclusion, I want to make sure everyone, we're here to listen. So we want to hear from you, but if we have time afterwards, I can maybe just give a quick primer on what the Commonwealth of Massachusetts has done in the past relative to collection of sales tax from online sellers and resellers, and what the status is. But I really want to listen to folks. So, is anyone else, please? Who's next? Right down in front, very good.
Probably go without a microphone. You know, Gary Rowe from Gary Rowe Hyundai. And I want to thank everybody for being here and sharing your concerns. I do echo the concerns about the minimum wage and sales tax, et cetera. But something that's pretty much specific to the auto industry is in the state of Massachusetts, we're at a competitive disadvantage to Connecticut and its neighboring states because we don't have what's called temporary registrations. So if you come in today to buy a car from me and you want to get new plates and the insurance company's not open or we don't have the staff at that moment, you can't pick up your car until tomorrow or the next day or the next weekend. And that gives people a chance to think about it and potentially change their mind. If you're in Connecticut, New Jersey, New York, they can issue you what's called a temporary registration, and that particular dealership has 30 days in order to complete the process. If we sell a car to someone in Connecticut or someone in New York, for example, we need to incur the labor of sending someone to the state of New York to complete that registration, get those plates, bring it back before that customer can take delivery of the car. So it's something we talked about in the past, is temporary registrations in Massachusetts, but nothing has really happened. So if you can consider that when you're talking to your colleagues, we would appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Please, don't be shy. Yes.
Thank you very much for being here today. And I'd also like to say thank you for the Retailers Association of Massachusetts. We're located in Palmer, and I'm PTS Supply, and we're in transportation and construction. Without the Retailers Association of Massachusetts, for example, we wouldn't be able to afford our health care, but because we're part of the group, we can do these things like that. What I'd like to just say today is, I hope that everybody can bring back to Boston, is there such a state of urgency throughout Western Massachusetts, especially for small businesses, that we need help. We can't wait any longer. I think the most important thing is, and I've been involved in these discussions in the past over the last 4 or 5 years, what are the next steps? What can you do to help us now get out of some of these situations that are really binding our hands and not allowing us to grow? We're a small company with a big attitude, and we are growing, but I have to look at every single expense every day, and it breaks my heart that I want to put this money towards hiring new, young individuals. A lot will come from the regional vocational high school that I put a lot into training, but I have to offset that with all these costs that we're talking about and mitigate it. So we so much appreciate you being here, but please, there's a sense of urgency. We need next steps and we need it now. And most importantly, I think, is what I see every day, especially in my community. We're a little bit ways off, 30 miles or so, in the Palmer area, very rural area. We are suffering so badly because our youth are not getting employed. Nobody wants to spend the money on them. We have a huge heroin epidemic going on. And we want to employ these folks. We want to get the youth involved. And our hands are just so tied in so many different ways. I think it goes back to some of the things that people were saying here. Allow us to put that money into training, to promoting our youth, to promoting our communities. But it's urgency, folks. We need next steps. We have to get going to support small businesses in Western Massachusetts. Please bring that message back to us. Thank you.
Thank you. Down in front. Oh, sorry about that. No, we have someone right in front. Young lady. Anyone else wish to speak from the audience? morning.
Good morning. My name is Katie Gord, and I am the owner of Cooper's at Avalon. And I am a second-generation retailer. My parents started the business in 1973. But I'm also a landlord. My husband and I purchased the family property from my dad's trust. And the other building on the property is a 14,000 square foot, formerly the Country Square Furniture Shop in Avalon, which was vacant for 3.5 years. All my family tried to figure out what to do with this property. And it became apparent that it was going to have to be sold. And after doing much soul searching, my husband and I decided to buy it, knowing that it was too big for it to be in one thing, with a vision of making it into a lot of little things that would hopefully draw more business for Cooper's, which I should probably tell you, Cooper's is a gift apparel and home store. So we were looking to attract women to be more customers. So we went into this, I guess, very naive as to what it would cost to renovate this 14,000 square foot building and bring it into compliance with ADA accessibility. And we have not only become developers, we've also become business incubator for a lot of small businesses. And we've got quite a mix of businesses in that building. We actually have 14 spaces now. And we've had some retailers also. It's been a very interesting process to watch, and I would suggest that one way that you would be able to help people that are in retail or looking to get into retail these days, because it has changed so fundamentally, would be education. And I feel that a lot of people go into retail and think, oh, this is going to be fun. Retailing has been fun since about 2007, I can tell you that, it ain't that easy either. But I think that education, there's a lot of programs out there that I can purchase that will teach me what I need to do to compete in today's market and to be seen in social media and to be seen out there in the marketplace. But it's expensive to purchase those programs. If there was online educational programs that could be accessed through our community colleges, I think it would help these people tremendously to have some inkling of what it's going to take to be in business, get in business, and stay in business. I think education would be enormously helpful. Also at a cost, I understand that doesn't come for nothing. One other suggestion also is, I have to give a shout out to American Express for creating the Small Business Saturday Initiative. Love the American Express. That is absolutely my biggest day of the year for the last 4 years. But I can't survive on one day a year. People need to be educated, constantly educated about what small business does in their communities and how much more we give back than the big box stores do. I started an initiative in my store called the Revenue Program in 2014. And every time a customer comes up to the register, we ask them if they'd like to round up their sales to the next dollar. And that will be donated to whatever the local charity is for that month in Cooper's. And we match 50% of what they do. And it might be small potatoes, but since 2014, we've hit the $10,000 mark.
This meeting, like so many others, really was the vision of Senator.
President Rosenberg. His theme of shared leadership in the Massachusetts State Senate does not mean just shared leadership amongst the four state senators that are here, two Democrats and two Republicans. It doesn't mean shared leadership by only the majority party, but we are truly engaged bipartisan body in the state senate. But it means shared leadership with all of you in our communities, whether it was through the Commonwealth Conversations Initiative, whether it was through the Millennial Engagement Initiative, whether it's through the Transportation Infrastructure Initiative. We think that in order for us to develop good, sound policy, we need to be as open and inclusive and listen to as many people as possible. So thank you all very much for coming out today. Senate President Rosenberg appointed myself as chair and Senator DiMacedo as vice chair of this task force because we both come from a retail background. My family's been in the retail floor covering business since 1962. And much to my chagrin, my son is now in the business for third generation. I'm proud of him, he's doing a great job, but the challenges that you all talk about, I and my family has lived every day. Probably less so in our industry, not retail segment, with online resellers, because our product really is two components. It's the materials, but it's also the professional installation. And you cannot buy that online. Our big change in our industry happened about 20 years ago with the big box retailers. When I was growing up in the business, and my dad before me, our competition was primarily family-owned, small, like-kind businesses. It would not be unusual for a community like Northampton to have three or four floor-covering stores, carpet stores, in the community. That all changed with the big box retailers. And there was an example of a product that sold at retail for a dollar more or a dollar less than they would buy at wholesale. It absolutely happens in the floor covering world also, so I can understand that. So we will take everything we hear, we will be issuing a report, and our openness and transparency will be online, we'll be able to read it, we'll be able to comment on it, and hopefully digest and get back to us. Just quickly about online sales tax collections. Two things have to happen in order for the state to begin collecting sales tax from online retailers. The first, because of the Supreme Court decision, God bless you, the first is that Congress has to act. Because there was a Supreme Court decision, the Quill decision, that states that a business must have nexus, quote unquote, nexus within the state, which nexus is defined as a physical presence, in order for a state to require them to collect and remit sales tax. Now, we have tried, to his credit, Governor Baker has tried, to define nexus not as a physical presence, but an economic presence by establishing a certain economic activity level by which it can be argued that your business, your retail industry has a nexus in the community. That will be challenged, is being challenged. The second, so we have a federal issue, which I know John Hurst and the Retail Association has been very, very involved in, and we thank them for their help, because it really is all about Main Street fairness. The second thing is that we in the state, the legislature, has to enact some regulatory administrative issue to be able to deal with that in order for our Department of Revenue that collects sales tax, in order for them to require online sellers to collect and remit. We've done that, I think, three times already. So we're ready. The legislature is ready to begin collecting the sales tax being remitted by online sales retailers, but the other mechanism, the federal mechanism, has not been done yet. And as far as the impact on the state, sales tax is a very, very important source of revenue in the state. Our sales tax is 6.25% in Massachusetts. New York is 8.875. Connecticut is 6.35. Where my business is, I border the Rhode Island border, it's 7%. So we have the lowest sales tax from all those states. But we don't have lower than New Hampshire. New Hampshire's zero. You can't get any lower than zero. So it has a very disproportionate impact on our retail friends up in the Merrimack Valley and on the Rhode